thank you very much. And read the entire thing. How's everybody doing today? Cool. So my name is Madona, and I was expecting definitely to build an app, but due to time and also the way the formats change later, I decided to just walk us through examples and look at just how they compare. And I will definitely be taking Q&A later, and my voice is also a little bit, I wasn't shouting yesterday. Happened to have like a little cold that came in. But that said, let's get into it. So, I don't know what else. Are you all seeing those? Code generated? This is going to be cool. Let me see if the other one is like that. Oh, look at that. Did the format change? This is going to be cool. Maybe it's. Can you see words?
No,
you see that, yeah. Yeah, I know. It's pretty cool. Oh, well, you can see it there. Let's see. Oh, yeah, that might be it. Yeah, maybe you can change the font. I feel like the font will be easier. But as that happens, I can start introducing myself. My name is Madona. As I mentioned, recently I was excited to do a venture, leading my company. Of course, I still work as an Android engineer, which is what I've been doing for the past 8 years now. Almost 10 years. I started back in 2014, building Android. Not professionally, but I became professionally around 2016, all the way to now. It's been a fun journey. And over the years, I've learned a lot. And I'm actually now an expert in Android. And today I wanted us to just look at how Swift compares to Android. Because if you've worked, okay, so let me do this as the also lower down the fonts. How many of us here have tried, actually work on either Android or iOS? Oh, pretty cool. That's amazing, I love that. So we have a good, because I did gauge the audience just yesterday, just walking around, and I didn't notice many people actually do React Native, which is pretty interesting. But it's good to see we have some natives in the house. I don't ever remember a time when I was interviewed to become React Native developer. Everywhere I've gone, just, hey, can you write code in native Java and now Kotlin? But many people ask me why I decided to stay in Android and not venture into iOS, and I said, to me, it was accessibility, because I feel like Android is accessible around the world, and many people use Android. But that said, I feel like, But I think that right now, when I think about it, as my role continued to evolve, I noticed I started jumping into the iOS, because sometimes I'll be like, hey, Madona, do you want to help fix some bugs for iOS? And I thought, oh, why not? So right now, I don't feel like I would say I'm very passionate, not passionate, more like a very strict on Android only, but sometimes I do go both ways. Like I would go definitely look into iOS, go back here, and that text me about KMM, which is something I will also show later for anybody that's interested about Kotlin multi-platform. One more question before we continue. How many of us here know use Kotlin or Kotlin? Pretty cool. How about Java? Pretty cool. Any plans to move to start using Java? Oh, sorry, Kotlin. The ones we're using Java. Cool. Because Jetpack Compose uses a lot of Kotlin. That's why I asked. Because you cannot write Jetpack Compose without you knowing Kotlin. Because it's now entirely written in Kotlin, which is pretty nice. Because I've been doing it, and I feel like it really makes work easier for us as developers. I think. As that works. I used to work, we had like a 10% project where you would definitely spend like 2 weeks working on something you like. And that is a time when people now definitely do that. Like, let me go type this code base and see if I can make it common. However, I would like to say, I feel like there's no need for that too, because Java has improved. I don't know how many of us know how Java, I feel like, I don't want to get into the politics of it, but I feel like it was more of a big lawsuit, because Java is really nice, I mean, to be fair. And also, it's very advanced right now. Like, they have cool functions that, I mean, I feel like they're competing with Kotlin, you know? However, I feel like they're also losing because Kotlin now has been adapted for backend too. So there's a lot of competition there. So I think they just need to lose in there. I don't know. But I feel like they feel confident. So I would say definitely future code can be done in Kotlin, but you don't have to go into old code. Unless it's your personal project. For my personal project, my team, I did that. Rewrote all, because it was a way for me to learn. Because I feel like when I got into it, like, Kotlin, it was very hard. Because, you know, we are always very hesitant. Because, wait, I've been doing Java for 5 years, now you want me to start learning Kotlin? It was very tough. But going back there and converting those codes back made it very nice.
I'm a little bit changed on the east side.
Oh, damn. Can I use my laptop? Okay. Sure, go on.
Have you used Kotlin and Gradle at all?
Huh?
Kotlin and Gradle? Like, How's your experience been?
So, I mean, I think it's pretty fast. That's what I can say. However, I'm seeing a lot of, not debate, but it looks like Bates wants to come out to the developers too. And now it's like a competitor for Gradle. So I don't know how that goes, because I know big companies use that. Because it's very, I mean, Gradle is a very fast for developers. But I'm excited for that. But I've used it. It's, I feel like right now with my machine, it works pretty well. Can't complain. Because I have an M1, but I feel like it's still in the older machines, it's still an issue. Because my team is like a few seconds at a time, even a big project, which is something that I like. However, I feel like if I worked for Square, that would be a different situation. It's a bad story. So I would say definitely it's not bad.
You mentioned React Native, and it's funny, recently they've talked about that they'll be able to get to Kotlin soon and quicker for the underlying code that they have compared to Swift. Just feels like it speaks to interoperability.
Yeah. And the good thing is that the KMM, I feel like that's going to bring a lot of power to the developers. And I'm very open to it myself, because I was like, well, wait a minute, the code is in Kotlin. And however, I feel like iOS people would not like that as much. Because I feel like the reason as to why maybe React Native has issues with a lot of, maybe what I've heard people complain most about is because they are not given a lot of access from iOS, because, you know, they still want to own everything. So I want to see how KMM picks up. I have not experimented with it yet, but I've looked into a couple of sessions online, and it looks pretty nice. Yeah, I can say it's pretty good. And also one more thing, when you see how the code looks like, because I had to like snippets of the code, it's very good. Yeah.
We were trying to use it for share code from the web and iOS.
Any other questions? This is pretty good Q&A, because Phil and
I guess with, so you mentioned, of course, your background, like your personal projects that are passion projects, so from Java to Kotlin. And did you find that you had any cases where, if I'm not mistaken, I think Kotlin does allow you to, I mean, you could run Java code. because it's a superset based quad. It reminds me, I see parallels between JavaScript and TypeScript and Java and Kotlin, you know, so I'm just curious if you ran into that.
You've seen there, that's who I am. I'm also writing a book on Android that's coming out this July, so I'm excited about that. And what most excited about that book is that I talk about how actually back in the days there aren't as much things as they are right now in Android, which is super cool for developers, for future developers. So I think like I've talked about that. So this slide here, I just talk about what the UI is for anyone that doesn't know, but I feel like I'm already engaged with the audience here, and all of us here are pretty good in understanding what is a UI. Jetpack Compose is a modern UI toolkit for building Android apps using a different approach to UI programming. So again, this is just where you write the entire code in, for instance, Kotlin, without using any XML, which feels so good for me because I feel like XML is pretty hectic. And one advantage that I found to be, especially for Jetpack Compose, is that it's very easy to test, very easily to write, and just see all your views just render on the side. It's so amazing. And my biggest feature, actually, which is what I want to talk about, is let me show here. So funny enough, I also learned that this slide here is that Jetpack Compose and Swift UI Compose released in the same year. I know, I was like, wait, when I was doing my research, I was like, okay. And right now, more developers actually adapted both, which is very cool. So, and big companies, there's that push, you know, for big companies to pick up Jetpack Compose, and also Swift UI, because I feel like that's what we're using at work right now. Now, let's look at the code. This is what I wanted us to look into, the code. Now, this is a Jetpack Compose text. So, before you would think about an XML file that has, let's say, some XML format, but right now you write code this way. So the text is a component. And one thing that I like to tell developers is that take your time to dig into that component, like the text component. See what it does, see what it takes in. For instance, here this text has a text which will tell us whenever it's displayed, Jetpack Compose text, and then now it takes in a style, and then the modifier, which is the biggest part of Jetpack Compose, which is like so the modifier is what you use now to tell, let's say, your text. It's going to have, let's say, 60 MTP. It's going to fill either max or width, all that cool stuff. Now, in iOS, this is how it would look. As you notice, it looks very similar. So this is going to be very interesting when you see it. You'll be like, wow, so I can actually be an iOS developer. Because funny enough, Kotlin and Swift, they're very similar. That's why it was very easy for me when I was told, hey Madona, do you want to jump into this iOS code and look at why this bug is happening? I'm like, oh yeah, let me go look into the code. And when I looked at the code, it looked very similar. And I your outline text, have everything you want just right there. Because you can see, you can just tell him, hey, have a round color sheet of ATP. Before, for like, you had to go and, I mean, that's what I used to do, I don't know if all of us here did that. Go and Google how to put an outline text, have like a rounded corner or a box corner. Now it's very easy. And then as you can see there, you can also specify the borders. And again, one more thing that I'm also insisting, please make sure you, when you start building or looking into this, always jump into the component and see what the component takes. It really informs you as a developer on what you would build on based on that information. To me, that's what I use, and I find it to really work pretty well. And helps my development faster. I feel like that's why they're pushing for it, because it's very creative. Now, let's look at an iOS outline text, how it looks. Now, that's a text view for iOS. As you see, very similar. No big difference. And then also something fun that I found out about Swift is that they have a dollar sign that Kotlin uses too. So if you've used Kotlin, you will notice they have a dollar sign too. Let me see. Now, let's look at a button. Buttons are very, so when I was writing this talk, I wanted to pick the most used UI components so that it can be easier for anybody new to just go and create this project very easily and just look at all the way those things work. Now, look at a button. So a button takes in an onClick. Now, this is, okay, yeah, before, in XML, definitely we had that onClick function. Sorry, not a function, but an onClick value on the XML. But right now, to make it easier, you can see it right there on the button once you enter it. You can do something, and then you can modify your button. You can make it have anything you want. And then it has like a row scope where the text, that is the text that the button will have. So every time somebody sees a button, they'll see Jetpack Compose button because you've given the text. You can also decorate that text, which makes it much better when you think about it. I know this is, I'm excited to talk about this because as a developer, I feel like my life was changed. I'm not trying to dramatize it, but that's true. Okay, let's, now this is how an iOS button will look like. See, very similar, it has like a row scope over there that has a text, and then as you can see in this text, I did do a couple of modifications to the text. So, and then the action right there is like on click, do something. I'm hoping I'm convincing people here to look into both because it's becoming much easier. Now, let's see a column, which is something that's used a lot in Android and also iOS. So, this is how a column looks like. So, you would have a column, and then instead of column, you'll definitely pass some parameters, and here you can see you can, again, I would insist on this. When you're writing the code, just make sure you jump into the, let's say, the column and see what the column takes in, and then you can modify it based on that. As you can see, they have a modifier. I said the padding to be 16. I can say I want that column to fill the entire max, or to fill the entire width, or to have certain colors. And if I wanted to have like a background, I'll just say an image. And also, it becomes easy because you can also start creating like boxes in this column. And to me, that makes work very easy when you think about it. Because before, it would take so much time. Now, this is how like an iOS column would look like, which has. I will also share these slides for whoever wants to go play around with it and build the app, which is like an app. And that's how, let's say, let me see. I wanted to show the KMM because cats are also very important and used a lot. So the KMM is definitely similar to what a lot of people do or react native people. And let me show you a couple of KMM code. So this is how the KMM code looks like. That's how we would definitely create a card. And this is the most interesting part. So when you create that one, it actually creates both, like iOS and Android, which makes it much easier. And I find this pretty nice for indie developers, especially if you're if you're an indie developer or a small startup that's trying to build your MVP pretty fast, always go with either React Native or KMM. I feel like that will save a lot of bandwidth and money, because it's way straightforward and easy. And let me see, that's how KMM card will look like. As you see again, there's that pattern of like similar to Jetpack Compose that's very straightforward. So if you see here,